wondering about that question, this is your sign. I'm here today. So, you know, it's never too late. We've had folks in their 80s go to seminary. So if God is calling you, let me know. I'm here for it. I want to thank so many of you for wearing masks today to protect me and the baby. Oh, that's lovely sounds from the bell
section.
So yeah, this baby is due in about 6 weeks, which would make it an especially dangerous and inconvenient time to catch COVID. But I want to make sure that everybody's clear on what my safety parameters are, which were that if we were going to be inside, I needed everybody to wear a mask. Since we're outside, feel free to take your mask off if you're not going to be within 6 feet of me or so. We don't need people overheating. It's already hot enough out here.
Thank you.
So, the other safety accommodation that we're going to do today is that while I will preside at communion, I'm not going to distribute it. And that will keep me from getting too close in contact with folks. But yeah, all of these things we have to think about now that there's this pandemic raging around us and continues to go on. What announcements do we have this morning? What needs to be known for the good of this community?
Good morning, Diane Ball here. Just very quickly, if you know of a graduate that you would like to have honored at an upcoming service in August, date will be to be announced. Please let me or Sue, Jacob in the office know so that we can do that. And secondly, there is going to be a CPR first aid training class that will be held August 9th from 6 to 9 here in Dorcas Hall. If you are interested, you get recertified if you are already certified. Get in contact with Donna Blackburn. Sue Jacob in the office has her email address. And we apparently get a really good deal on the price. It's like almost half price from what I understand. It's, I believe, $55. So it's a great opportunity for us. Thank you.
Just a word about the music. As you're all aware by now, these outdoor services are beautiful, but you get a nice wind across the hill here. And below is my views are all over the place, so sometimes there's little interruptions while I have to go retrieve something. I've also made a change. I picked for a prelude a nice 17th century German hymn. It's in my bloodstream. But I always change my mind when I get out here, because I look at the trees and I get this peaceful feeling when the bells aren't ringing. I'm also killing time now because I know they're going to end in about a minute. So if I keep talking, I'll be able to play without them over top of me. But I'm going to pick an old Welsh hymn. There are certain cultures that just seem to really have a handle on hymnody. And the Welsh, in my opinion, are one of those. And I think it has something to do with what you see when you're going about your daily life. The other kinds of music that really touches me are Irish, old Irish tunes. And I didn't really understand why until I went to Ireland 13 years ago and stood on the cliffs looking out over the ocean. And now I could hear those Irish chants and why that music came out of that place. And so we don't have the mountains, the craggy, rocky hills like they have in Wales, but we have these trees. So I'm going to play an old Welsh hymn, Be Thou My Vision. I hope it's a compatible key with my neighbors. Probably won't be. Thank you.
and let's stand as we begin worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven and you are free to love as God loves. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
light of your church. Open our hearts to the riches of your grace, that we may be ready to receive you wherever you appear. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from Genesis. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be read responsibly. Happy is the nation whose God is the Lord. Happy are the people chosen to be God's heritage.
The Lord looks down from heaven and sees all humankind.
God sits firmly enthroned and watches all who dwell on the earth.
God fashions all their hearts and observes all their deeds.
A king is not saved by the size of the army, nor are warriors rescued by their equal strength.
The horse gives vain hope for victory. Despite its great strength, it cannot save.
Truly your eye is upon those who fear you, O Lord, upon those who wait for your steadfast love,
to deliver their lives from death, and to keep them alive in time of famine.
Our inmost being waits for you, O Lord, our helper and our shield.
Surely our heart rejoices in you, for in your holy name we put our trust.
Let your loving kindness, O Lord, be upon us, even as we place our hope in you. A reading from Hebrews. Now faith is the assurance of hope, things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. By faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundation, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, he received power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth, for people who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they had left behind, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is,
They desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet, so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Where is your heart? Right? Ba-dum. We can feel it on the left side of our body, pumping blood everywhere from our brain to our toes to maintain all of our essential functions. And that beating heartbeat is the essence of our lives. Without it, we would quite literally cease to exist. So how is it that we are supposed to identify the heartbeat of our soul and our spirit? How do we pick out what gives us joy, what keeps us lit up, giving us life beyond just that physical pumping of blood? Y'all may know from the newspapers that our fellow disciples out in California get a lot more experience with that than those of us on the East Coast. They say you can identify what is most important to you by what you'd save in the event of a fire. You get a notice to evacuate, so you pack up the kids, you pack up the dog. What else are you going to grab and stick in the car? Just in case the worst happens. Just in case you come home to total devastation. Are you going to take what's financially valuable? Take what's sentimental, maybe a mix of both. In today's gospel lesson, Jesus gives us another way to tell what's most important to us. Jesus says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So how do you spend your monthly budget? What do you prioritize with your spending? Budget experts tell us that housing should be roughly a third of our budget. And if you're spending more than that, maybe you value having a nice, comfy place to come home and relax. Maybe you prioritize eating out because of the new culinary adventures you get to have, trying food from all kinds of different ethnic groups. Maybe you make sure to set aside money each month so you can travel, right? Take the kids to Disney World, head west to see the Grand Canyon and the other national parks. Hop a plane to Europe. See what the rest of the world has to offer. And it turns out we can do the same thing with our church budgets. Budget documents are mission documents. So what does it say if we claim our children are the most important things to us and we budget them $50 a year to buy a couple new packs of markers, while we spend $100 a month, say, on our coffee hours? So sometimes I go around to new call committees and let them practice on me as a mock interview before they interview their real candidates. And some are surprised when I ask any questions at all about the budget that gets included in the call paperwork. They say, well, Pastor, we don't have anybody on the committee who knows anything about the budget. We'd have to ask the finance people. Okay, go do that. Spend some time with them. Because I tell them I could ask questions entirely about their budget and get a pretty good idea about whether or not God was calling me to be pastor of that particular congregation. See, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And this line from Jesus, it comes after an invitation to sell your possessions, give alms to the poor. And it comes right before this parable about being ready and watching for the master who's arriving home late from a wedding. And both of these lines, the parable and the invitation to sell everything, have been used to strike fear into the hearts of their listeners. Right? Wondering if you trust God enough to sell everything and give up all of your earthly possessions. Worrying about when Jesus is coming back and if you've done enough to enter the kingdom. Y'all, preachers have used these lines across centuries to inspire desired Christian behaviors through fear instead of love. And yet our reading begins, "Do not be afraid, little flock. Do not be afraid. Fear is not the answer, and it is not the desired outcome of our Lord." See, Jesus continues that it is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. God wants you to be at peace. God wants you not to worry. God wants you to experience the fullness of joy that comes from knowing Jesus and being in a relationship with your Savior. And when we know that we don't have to worry in life or in death, we can start to experience that lightening of our possessions as more of an invitation than a command. See, because God has everything in hand, we can lean deeper into these promises of God. We can be freer with our heart, freer to love, freer to serve, freer to follow God and to live more fully into the kingdom. Where is your heart today, O people of God? Right? Can't you feel it beating in the music of our singing, in the fellowship of sharing the peace, in knowing that our children, from their very first breath, are learning that Jesus loves them? See, these are the things that we treasure. And this is our heart. Amen.
Thank you.
I invite you to confess your faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Y'all are right.
I receive the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come near to the Holy One in prayer. Let your loving kindness be upon your church. Fill all who proclaim the gospel with your spirit. Equip your flock to speak your word of promise and hope in the midst of fear and uncertainty. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Let your loving kindness be upon your creation. Dwell among us and sustain our earthly home. In places of famine, provide nourishment. In places of plenty, fashion us to be good stewards of your bounty. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Let your loving kindness be upon your world. Be our helper and our shield in places torn by strife and violence, especially Ukraine, Palestine, and Sri Lanka, raising up courageous leaders to govern with compassion and justice. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Let your loving kindness be upon your children. Look upon all who wait for your steadfast love. Console those who grieve and embrace those who cry out to you, especially those for whom we pray. Help us to trust your promise and not be afraid. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Let your loving kindness be upon this community. Passion our hearts to strive for the way of peace. Strengthen the outreach ministries of St. Peter's, like Penridge Fish, the New Britain Food Pantry, the Keystone Opportunity Center, and all who care for those in need. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
With thanksgiving, we remember all who have died in faith and now rest in you. As they place their hope in you, so strengthen us to trust in your promise of new life. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, our holy wisdom. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you. I
invite you to share that peace with one another.
Peace be with you.
Yeah.
out of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Please rise. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We gather to tell the story of God's love every week. But there is one story that is so important that we tell it each and every time that we gather. The story of how on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come to the banquet, for all is now ready. Please be seated, and I'd ask our communion assistants to come up and distribute communion.
Thank you.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you forever in God's grace.
Amen.
Life-giving God, through this meal you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus.
Amen. And now as you prepare to leave this place, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you with grace and with mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.